Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Again, this is Dr. Sheila Quinn with the South Carolina Department of Education. I work with the Division of Innovation and Effectiveness, and we're delighted to be able to be with you across the state for our second statewide faculty meeting. We actually had 1,500 people registered for this meeting today, which is terrific. And I want you to know that a lot of what we're going to share with you today, the team that's here, we've shared this with your district testing and accountability coordinators, with district test coordinators who came to a meeting last week. We will be sharing this as well with the personnel roundtable this Friday. But we felt the need to actually get the information directly to teachers and principals and assistant principals because you're on the front lines and you need the information as fast as you can. So we've assembled a team here today to talk to you about what we consider two hot topics. The first one is assessment and our new SC Ready test. And our second one is educator evaluation. Many of you know with the Every Student Succeeds Act, there's been some flexibility allowed by the state, and we have put out some guidance about that flexibility, but we really want to get that information directly to teachers. So we welcome your questions today. We will be recording this webinar so that it can be used at a later date should you choose to do that. We invite you to type in your questions as you're hearing the presentation. We will take time at the end of the presentation to answer questions. So feel free to be sure that we know all of your thoughts. If we need to follow up with any information, we will do that to the districts. This link for the webinar will be available on the State Department webpage. It will also be sent out from our friends at SCASA, who are gladly sharing their space and their equipment today to let us film and record, this webinar. So SCASA will be sending out this link to its members, and the link will be on the State Department webpage. I want to personally thank the team members that we have here today. We have a room full of people prepared to answer your questions. Doing the bulk of the presentation will be Liz Jones from the Office of Assessment and Kristen Joannis from the Office of Educator Effectiveness. So I'm going to turn it over now to Liz Jones, and thank you very much, Liz.
Thank you. All right, the bulk of my presentation today is about the SC Ready test. I am going to start out, though, and tell you one thing about SC Pass test, and that is that we are testing science and social studies this afternoon. We are testing science and social studies this spring in grades 4 through 8. And there seems to be confusion about that, so I really wanted to make sure that that was understood across the state. For SC Ready, we awarded a contract on December the 1st. For the test, the test will be for ELA and mathematics in grades 3 through 8. In spring 2016, we are offering the test online and in paper pencil format. In spring 2017, state law requires that we test or administer the test online only. So districts need to be preparing to give that test online for next year. The SC Ready test includes items that are aligned to the South Carolina College and Career Readiness Standards and that were developed by our contractor and have been field tested. The test also includes items from the Terra Nova test, and those items are included so that we can provide national comparison information for students. The ELA test will be administered over 2 days, Session 1 and Session 2. Each day will take approximately 2.5 hours to administer. The next slide is a slide that shows you a draft test blueprint. The blueprint is a document that gives you information about how many items are on the test. This is not an absolute final, but this is very close to the final. If you look, you'll see that in grades 3, 4, and 5, there are 84 items for students to take, there'll be 84 points on the test. And at grades 6, 7, and 8, there will be 96 points on the test. Now, remember that those tests are given over 2 days. So some of the items will be given one day and some will be given the next day. You can see that there are test items for writing inquiry, and for reading literacy text and reading informational text. I have brought with me some folks today that are here. Some of them will give you some information, and others are here to answer questions. I did not introduce everybody that I have with me, and I'm going to do that now. Sheila Graybill is with me, Mimi Brailsford, Harriet Pritchard, and Jeannie Howard, who all work with the test development. They work on developing items. They work on developing test forms. So they're here to answer questions. And Suzanne Swafield and Ann Mers are here, and they work on ensuring that students have the appropriate accommodations. Jeannie Howard is going to talk to you a little bit about the item types on the ELA test.
Hello, everybody. We're glad you're able to join us for this, and we know you have lots and lots of questions about this new SC Ready test. Hopefully, we can answer some of that with these slides. The first one I'd like to show you are some of the item types that you're going to experience with this new test. The first is one that is kind of an old friend. You've seen it before, selected response, but in this case, it might be selected responses. So I think most of you know exactly what kind of item that looks like. Now, this next item type is a little different. Now, we've seen this particular item type on the end of course test, but it will be new for 3-8. And this is basically what it amounts to. You can see on the screen what it says, but it's basically a two-parter. So you might have part A, which might ask the student to draw an inference, and he would be given options for that inference. And then the second part, which would be part B, would ask him to, where is the evidence for that particular inference that I've just drawn? And then again, you would have four options to choose from. So think about that. We call it an EBSR. Think about it as being a two-parter question. Now, the next item type, and I think this is the one that most people have the most questions or concerns about. So let's see if we can just go ahead and address that. Look at what it says, a text-dependent analysis, better known as a TDA. And we'll have these in grades 3-8. And basically, here's what happens. A student will read a piece of text or a passage, and from that text or passage, he's got to gather some evidence. So he's going to have to analyze that piece. And then what he will be asked to do is to take a prompt, and based on what that prompt is asking him to do, he's got to respond to that text. I'm going to show you an example of that just in a few minutes, so just hang on. All right, now here is the rubric. Now, folks, this is a new rubric. It's different from the one that we've had in the past in this way. This is called a holistic rubric. In other words, when you look at this piece of writing, you're going to look at it as a whole piece. You're not going to look at it and say, well, let's see, this might be content development, and here over here might be organization, and here's some points over here for conventions. This is a holistic rubric. So you look at that piece of writing as a whole. And there'll be more information for you concerning how to work with this rubric. But I think you're going to find really in the end that it's easier to grade with a holistic rubric than it is to do with domain scoring. So make sure that in your schools you're taking a real good look at what these bullets really do represent. And then you can let us know if you have questions. We're here to answer those for you. Okay, the next thing, and this I think would be your best friend. This is your writer's checklist. This one in particular is for grade 3, but it looks exactly like the grade 4-8, with the exception of the word that you see in red, response. We looked at some of the prompts, and we realized that at grade 3, the word essay is not used in the prompt. So to make it more user-friendly for our grade 3 students, we just changed that word essay to response. But the writer's checklist is exactly the same with the exception of that one word. So let me show you, did we not have a grade 4? That's okay. All right, so your grade 4-8 is going to have, where you see in red response, you're going to see the word essay in your grade 4-8. Now, Let's look at a text-dependent analysis, better known as TDA, grade 4 sample item. Here's the prompt. Write an essay analyzing how the author's organization of the passage helps the reader to understand the tasks. Use information from the passage to support your response. Just exactly the kind of question that we want to do in our classrooms to make sure that our students are doing exactly that. Now, here, and this is on the web, so you can look at this at your leisure, but just want to show you what this text-dependent analysis text looks like. So this is called Trekking the Trail. I'm going to go through this very quickly. All right, here's some more of that same piece of text. So this is about a hiking journal here. And here's something that the author has put in about a hiking stick. So at your leisure, go over this piece of text. Look to see exactly what it is your students will be reading. Again, this is a sample item. And then I'm going to go back to that prompt again. So he's read that piece of text, that entire piece of informational text, and now he's going to write an essay analyzing how the author's organization of the passage helped that reader to understand the tasks. So if you go back over there and look at that, hiking stick is bolded, hiking journal is bolded, trekking the trail is bolded. So right away you can see how that author has basically outlined that passage for that reader. So now, I'm going to quit there and turn this over to Harriet Pritchard to do the math.
Thank you, Jenny. That was very good information. Before Harriet begins, I want to let you know that for math, there are two sessions, both given in one day. So, and there's not a break in between those tests. We will give a calculator section first, and then children will immediately go to a non-calculator section. Teachers will collect the calculators from each child as they finish the test and then allow the child to go into the non-calculator section. Those two sections together will take the students about 2 hours it's estimated it'll take about 2 hours for the students to finish that. So Harriet is going to talk to you a little bit about the calculator use policy. Thank you.
As you can see, grades 3 through 5 will have no calculators. Calculators are only allowed in 6 through 8. There will be the two sections. If the student is taking the test online, they will have access to a built-in calculator, either a four-function, or for grade 8, it'll be a four-function, and a scientific calculator. In addition, if a child prefers to use a handheld calculator, that is acceptable. Any calculators brought in, though, from the districts or the schools or the students will have to have the memories cleared, and this same clearing policy that we've had in the past with other testing. The teachers will take, or the test administrators will take up the calculators after the calculator section, and the students will not be allowed to go back to the calculator section. Online, there will be no access to that calculator section, but paper pencil, they should not be permitted to go back. I think that's, you've seen this policy before, so that shouldn't be any surprise. And here's information about the resetting. If they have pressed a test or test guard, that is acceptable, that they will not have to clear the memories. But otherwise, the memories of the calculators have to be cleared, and the students need to be told that if they don't want their memories cleared, they will not be allowed to use that calculator. These are the blueprints. The range, the number of items will vary somewhere between 7 and 9 in number sense and base 10. As you can see, it'll depend on just certain instances of what kinds of items we have available. I think we can just flip through all of these. The test blueprint, this draft test blueprint, is available online, and you can see it. It is a tentative number. We will have some additional Terra Nova items that may bring the total up somewhat above this. We don't know yet exactly how many that will be. We have selected response items. They're your standard multiple choice with four options, and the student selects one. We will also have some that are multi-select. The student is asked to select all that are true or all that apply. There may be five options to choose from there. Then there's the short answer and the gridded response. The short answer will apply to the online, and the gridded response will be a parallel item for the paper pencil test. They will essentially be asking the same thing. We have some technology enhanced items. They might include drag and drop, put things into categories, hotspot. Could be something like a matching where you're matching this entity with that entity or graphing. On the paper pencil assessment, they will have a comparable selected response item to replace that. So the paper pencil test will be the same length and the same basic difficulty as the online test.
All right, as they've mentioned, all of the information that we have at this point is posted on our website. As we get more information that we have to share, we'll also post that on the website. If you want to go to ed.sc.gov and you hover over the word tests, and there are five different sections under tests: assessment information, that's general information like test dates, things like that. And then we have all of the elementary tests under elementary, and then the middle school test under middle. Now you will find that SE Ready is listed under elementary and middle because it's given in both elementary and middle school grades. So it doesn't matter which one you click on there. And then we have information about high schools and then adult testing. And I just wanted to click on the middle school. You'll see that you have a bunch of boxes on that page, and one box for each testing program so that you can get more information about that testing program. And you'll notice that the SE Ready assessments box is in red. It's on near the bottom in the middle. And if you go there, you'll find information about all the topics that we've discussed today. And, of course, we'll let you type in your questions, and that's all the information we have about the SE Ready test.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. We're going to change subjects here for a bit, and then we'll circle back to questions about both assessment and educator evaluation at the end. I'm Chris Joannis. I'm the Director of Educator Effectiveness, and I bring you some good news. You'll recall that we were with you not too long ago talking about some things that we were considering in requesting for revisions in the system guidelines. But in between point A and B, there was a ESA reauthorization that occurred in December, and that really changes our landscape significantly. So I'd like to talk to you a little bit about what does it mean for educator evaluation. And you'll notice in the center of the screen, there are three key words here, and this is becoming our mantra in the Office of Educator Evaluation. We view this reauthorization as an opportunity to develop a system of evaluation that's meaningful, one that's aligned to the intent, and the intent really truly should be around professional development and growth of teachers, not about compliance with an ESA waiver. And thirdly, and probably most importantly, the gift of time is going to allow us to do this thoughtfully. So it is our intent to develop a system that's meaningful, aligned to the intent of professional growth and development, and thoughtful in implementation. And quite honestly, that's the piece that was missing in all of the work to date, is a timeline that allows that to be done thoughtfully. So we're going to try to do this in a way that allows us to get where we want to be. We're going to get it right. So I'm excited to be with you today. So just to give you some context, we had recently been approved for a 3-year flexibility waiver in June, and that flexibility waiver required some changes in our educator evaluation system. And that was what was pushing on the development of the expanded ADEPT and PEDEP system. Well, recently we have reauthorized that ESEA language, and what it's done is it's pushed more flexibility to the state level to determine how educators should be evaluated. As a result, Superintendent Spearman rallied us internally to talk about what this would look like if we could take the time to do this thoughtfully. Thankfully, we had a lot of feedback from the field already, so we knew where some of the contentious points were. And so we rallied and went to the board January 13th and requested some approval to the revisions of the 2015 guidelines. Again, the idea here is that we want to build a meaningful system aligned to the intent of professional growth and development and thoughtful in implementation. So that ESA flexibility waiver was based on some requirements. And I want to take a minute to review those requirements here, because even though there was an ESA flexibility waiver that we were trying to get approval on, these requirements, I think, are important to note, as they are still important. So we have no intention of going backwards in our evaluation of educators. We want to move forward, and we want to move forward with best practices. So I think every educator out there would agree that it's still important that educator evaluation is used for continual improvement of instruction. We would also agree that it should differentiate our performance on more than two levels, and that's our current state of the state. We're either met or we're not met. And if you think about that, there's a sigh of relief where we say, "Ooh, goodness, thank goodness I've met. I've been met." But then we pause and we say, "Just how met was I? And what do I need to get to be more met?" And that really does not give us the specific information we need to grow in our practice, and most importantly, move the lever on student outcomes. We would probably also agree as a profession that it is important to look at student growth within teacher evaluation. The question is, how do we do that thoughtfully? And so we're going to revisit this notion of student growth, and we're going to look at removing it as its own isolated measure and using that student growth data to inform professional practice. We would all agree that we should be evaluated on a regular basis. If you have engaged in collegial conversation with your veteran teachers, especially if you've been in it as long as I have, you would probably hear a common theme, and that is that years go by and we're absent of some specific feedback related to practice, and we're actually hungry for people to come in and talk to us about what we're doing well and what we could do to improve. So we need to continue down the path of regular feedback. So no one in our profession would agree that we need to go backwards. So how do we move forward in a thoughtful manner? That's what we're looking at internally, and we're excited to share four things that we presented to the board on January 13th that I think will help us to move in the right direction. First and foremost, we asked for an extension of timeline. In case you didn't know, we're operating under what would have been our first year of full implementation of the expanded system. Well, no news to you, we still have a system to develop. So we asked for full implementation to begin in 2018-19. And we'll get into the fact that we still have pieces to build yet, let alone perfect the student growth collection. The second request we asked was we wanted to remove the requirement for test score-based measures to be part of an educator evaluation system. Now, that means our value-added measures. We want to remove that as a required component. That doesn't mean that that's not an important source of information, but we want to remove it as a required piece of student growth measures from the system. That means that we need to focus our energies on the student learning objectives, the SLOs. And we'll talk specifically about SLOs later on. Good, bad, or ugly, the SLO process is making changes in our schools, and I'll share with you what that is. But we would like to use that to inform professional practice ratings within the four domains, rather than use it as a standalone, isolated measure that is weighted. Last but not least, we want to engage educators and teachers in particular in feedback opportunities in the months of February and March to get specific feedback to the revisions that we're proposing in the system. Your voice is important, and I will share some of the details related to the focus groups later on in the presentation. Well, if you look at our existing guidelines, you'll see a timeline, and of course, you'll see 15-16 as being the year of full implementation. So what would it look like to recalibrate? And that's what we're calling 16-17. It gives us an opportunity to breathe and to think thoughtfully about what it might look like. As you all know, we still have a rubric to identify, and we need to train on a new observation rubric, and we need to implement that rubric into the evaluation of practice in a thoughtful manner. So what we might be looking at is using SAFE-T, not a hybrid like we're doing this year, but SAFE-T to continue to evaluate until we have the system in place, the tool in place, and most importantly, the training in place to observe on a new rubric accurately and with fidelity. We also have online data management system to identify and to develop and to train. And again, that's a big lift. And we want to make sure that we're doing that thoughtfully and that we're doing it in a timeline that allows districts to align at the district level in order to make sure that by 18-19, everybody has everything they need in place to begin full implementation. So we've got a lot of system building to do, let alone training. So this extended timeline is going to allow us to slow the train down. It's going to address the feedback related to it's too fast, it's coming too soon, we need to address capacity in our district related to training, and so we're going to slow it down. So let's take some time to talk about the changes in student growth. While we would recognize that including student growth in teacher evaluation was probably the most significant change that was made from the old way that we did evaluation, this again is one of the significant areas that we're looking at revising going forward. If you had the opportunity to study the 2015 classroom-based teacher expanded ADEPT guidelines, which I'm sure all of you have taken the time to do, you would have seen that really student growth could have been collected in two ways. The first way that student growth can be collected is through a calculation that's applied to the state standardized tests. And we call that value-added measures, and we've contracted with a vendor called EVAS, and so you've probably heard these two acronyms used a lot. Well, these test score-based measures were required in the ESA flexibility waiver, and they had to be used in some capacity within the student growth measure of teacher evaluation. For those that were not in tested grades and subjects, we were looking at a more teacher-based growth goal approach using SLOs. Districts could, in fact, choose to use a combination of both if they wanted, meaning all teachers were writing SLOs, but then value-added measures needed to be incorporated. Well, if you add on top of the fact that value-added measures have a significant delay, meaning the reports from last year are just now in the hands of districts this year, that poses a significant problem with factoring it into teacher evaluation. So we had moved already in the direction of student learning objectives for all for the year of 15-16, and good news, because that's probably the route we're going to be going, and that means all of you have had practice. Now, I want to remind you all that it's a presumed proficiency year, and while we didn't call it a practice year, we're saying that we need to understand that student learning objectives is a new experience and that we need to make sure that we're engaged in that process thoughtfully. So you might be asking, well, why aren't we getting rid of student learning objectives they're not required anymore? Well, I've already shared with you that we would all agree professionally that looking at student growth is still an important thing to do. And really, that's why we're in the business we're in, is we want to make sure that we're impacting what happens for students academically. But if you can sort through all of the noise and the chaos of this past year, there were actually some really positive things happening out there. We heard messages like what you see here, that we've never looked at student data like we are now, and the SLOs are pushing us to adjust instruction daily in our classrooms. The SLOs provide a means for me to demonstrate that I'm making academic gains with my students. And the list goes on. And yes, I would acknowledge that it's not been all a bed of roses with SLOs out there. But what that does is that means that's up to us. We need to own that. The department and my office needs to own the fact that we need to do a better job of training. We need to do a better job of training the sub-skills that are inherent in SLOs, as well as training on the process of creating quality SLOs, monitoring SLOs. But guess what? We now have the timeline to do that. So we're going to stay the course, and we're going to build our skills. And 3 years from now, we are going to be exceptional at writing SLOs. But remember, one of the pieces that we really want to look at is removing the SLO as an isolated measure and using that information, of which we would all agree there's a lot of comprehensive information that goes into an SLO planning template. But how might that be used? How might all of those pieces be used to inform ratings in the professional practice domains? Well, let's take a look. We have the domain of planning. In long-range planning, you certainly can get a sense or a feel for a long-range planning of a teacher when you're looking at an SLO that covers the interval of time he or she is leading instruction with students. It gives a lot of insight into the collaboration that teacher is using with specialists in his or her classroom and building. It gives a lot of foresight into the assessment practices of the teacher and their understanding of the standards. And you could go on and on with the remaining domains and how it peers into the planning for all of these professional practices. We have a lot of work to do with making the SLO a thoughtful, meaningful artifact. But this is what we would like to spend 16-17 exploring. Let us not forget the principles. The principals also had a student growth leadership standard added to their evaluation. So likewise, we're going to be engaging with principal focus groups to talk about whether or not that should remain an isolated leadership standard or whether or not the student growth should be factored into some of the existing leadership standards. I'm going to skip this for time, but again, we requested and were approved 4 significant changes to the ADEPT system in order to develop a meaningful system aligned with the intent of professional growth and development and, bottom line, thoughtful in its implementation. So what are our next steps? You've heard a lot of reference to focus groups. Your voice is important to us. While we cannot conduct focus groups that are large in size, we are going to do what we can to engage as many teachers in focus groups as possible. They will be taking place in February and March in regional locations, and specific details around how to register as being considered for a focus group will be coming very shortly. It will be a self-nomination process for the teachers. It will not be a district-nominated list of names. We are going to create and publish an online survey that will be linked to our website and will be open to all educators and will mirror some of the very same things we're asking the focus groups. This will give everyone an opportunity to weigh in with his or her voice when it comes to changes in educator evaluation. We are going to continue to communicate new system development through our existing systems of communication to include professional organization newsletters. We will determine and communicate guidance for 2016-17 as soon as possible. And in lieu of that, or related to that, we will have an ADEPT plan webinar on March 21st at 9:30 a.m. So save the date for that if you are in charge of developing your district's ADEPT plan. And last but not least, after feedback is analyzed and we have a time to develop a thoughtful approach to teacher evaluation, we will bring the newly revised guidelines back to the Board of Education for approval. So what are your next steps? It's important to note that we need to continue under our current system guidelines for the year of 2015-16, as our current ESA waiver is in effect until August 1st of 2016. Watch for communications related to the teacher and principal focus groups, and please, please engage in the online survey. Help us to build a system that is meaningful, aligned to professional development, and thoughtful in implementation. And with that, I'm going to turn it over to the questions. Thank you all so much for your time today.
So we're going to begin to transition to your questions. And we are pulling those up now. If you'll give us just a minute to be able to pull those. I'm going to read the questions, and then we may have different people responding. So in order for them to move from their current seat to the microphone, there might be some delay. So just, we haven't gone anywhere. We're just going to manage this process with lots of voices potentially giving you answers. Okay, so the first question that I see is, can you explain the reasoning behind using a holistic rubric for grading the SC Ready?
Well, let me see if I can go at it this way. In watching what most states have done in the past, we have been one of the few states who used a domain rubric. I think that most people find the holistic rubric to be more user-friendly. It certainly goes faster. And I think for most of us, we're going to find as we get more familiar with it, that we're really going to like it better. Now, as to why the contractor chose that, I can't tell you that. So remember, this is an off-the-shelf test, and it came with some, I won't call them limitations, but it came with certain things that we really couldn't do too much about. But I really hope you'll hold on to that holistic rubric and give it a chance.
Okay, the second question is, in Enrich, the testing accommodations section, will accommodations for SC Ready testing be included in the options when writing IEPs prior to the end of the school year?
Yes. The Office of Assessment has worked collaboratively with the Office of Special Education Services to provide them with the list of accommodations that are available for SC Ready. OSIS is in turn working with the Enrich vendor to upload those. So they should be in the system soon. And in the meantime, the Office of Special Education Services is planning a webinar, I believe later this week. They would have information on their website as to what to do for accommodations this year.
Then it says, is there a way to print these out? Trying to see if that's related to the same question.
Okay. In terms of printing out a list of accommodations which will be available for SC Ready, the list that will go into Enrich is the same list that was included as an attachment to the December 31st memo that Liz Jones sent to district test coordinators. Your district test coordinator would have that table, and it is also available on the SC Ready webpage.
If this question is about printing out the rubrics from the previous question or about printing out the PowerPoint slides, those are going to be posted on the Department of Education website. We wanted to answer this question all three ways so that we can make sure that we're answering the question you're asking.
Okay, so the next three questions have to do with writing. The first one is, are students going to be timed? The second one is, will there be more ELA samples other than this fourth grade sample? And how many TDA questions will there be?
Okay, well, let me start with the last question first. There'll be one TDA question, the second question, I believe, had to do with the samples. If you will go to the website, you will see that there are actually two writing samples, two scored student responses for grade four. There are also two scored student responses for grade seven. So, and I think you'll see that you've got a variety of text in there for students to look at. In some cases, you've got informational text that the students have responded to. In some cases, and by the way, if you look at those scored sample items, that's going to help you enormously to understand that rubric. And then with grade seven, you have, I believe there's a narrative and maybe a letter. I'm not quite sure, but they're on the web already, there for you to look at and to practice with and to call and ask us questions if you have them. This rubric is going to be something that I think will really work for you, but you will need to look at some of those scored student responses to really get the hang of that rubric. The TDA, the tests are not timed. The the short answer is the tests are not timed.
And there was a lot of concern last year about the timed of the writing test, and the writing, of course, will not be timed either.
This next question is also about TDA, but it's an IEP question, so I'll let you read those. Anne, read those.
Okay. The next question says, for the TDA, can students that have IEPs and ELA have the passage read to them? Are you also testing just comprehension, just writing, or both for the TDA? So for this year on the SC Ready, we are not allowing oral administration of the TDA. Because the student response is text dependent, oral or signed administration is not going to be allowed this year. This is a new type of writing prompt that's based on the new South Carolina College and Career Readiness Standards. So a study will be conducted to determine if oral administration can be allowed on our future administrations of the Session 1 ELA test without invalidating the constructs that are being measured. In order for an accommodation to be available on a statewide assessment, it has to not invalidate the responses and the results that we're gathering. So we're still doing research into whether that will be allowed in the future.
The next question talks about supports in place for ELL students or special education students who have reading deficits. So you're still up, Anne.
Okay. Well, I think my last response probably also covers that one. So this year, oral administration as a specific support is not available on that TDA item. There are other accommodations which are available to ELL and special education students on the writing subtest. And again, that table that I referenced earlier, which went out in a memo as well as being available on the website, would provide information about those accommodations.
Okay, the next question has to do with math, and it says, if the test is not timed, do students just hand in their calculator at the end of one section and start the second section?
Yes, and it will be the teacher's responsibility to monitor which section the student is on. There will be a visual cue in the paper pencil test booklet that will make it easy for the teacher from a distance to see which section the student is on.
And on the online test, the student will not have access to the calculator section when they are or the non-calculator section when they're using the calculator.
The next question says, we know that there will be short answer responses as well. Just wanted to be sure that there is not another piece of writing that the students will be responsible for. Will there be another narrative? Any other short answer? Explain the writing load.
No, the only piece that the students will have to write will be the TDA. So there will not be any short answer questions in addition to that.
For the ELA test.
Okay, the next question is about high school, and the question is asking, will the juniors have a test this year? Yes, we will be offering the ACT to all grade 11 students as well as work keys to all grade 11 students.
Right, and I want to be real clear about this. For the ACT test, all high schools must offer the ACT test to every student. The student is not obligated to test if the student chooses not to test. That in work keys, all children must be tested.
The State Department has asked the federal government that our state tests for ELA and math in high school be English 1 and Algebra 1. We still have not gotten confirmation from the U.S. Department of Education that those are officially our high school tests. But we have requested those. The grade 11 ACT test will therefore hopefully not be our high school test. So being able to offer it to all students is why that language is changed that way. Okay, the next question, is the rubric the same South Carolina Ready link that you were just talking about? Is it under the same link that you were just talking about, the rubric for writing?
The rubric isn't the same link, so you can find that.
Next question, are there any sample math items?
We have not posted any sample math items yet. Our plan is to get math sample items and additional ELA items up as soon as we can do that.
The next question says, what accommodations will be available? If that's any different from anything you've said before.
No, again, all of the available accommodations are listed in the tables that are on the SC Ready webpage. That includes accommodations for students with disabilities as well as English language learners. There is a separate table for online testing as well as paper pencil testing. You can also find in that section best practices that are available to all students.
Next question is, when will districts receive the assessment results? Ms. Jones?
The districts will receive the assessment results in before the end of July. We don't have exact dates for that, but as soon as we have exact dates, we will post those and we will send that information to the district testing coordinators. We have to have standard setting in June. That means that we have to determine what the cut scores are for being proficient or considered college and career ready. And so that work has to be done in June. So the scores will be later this year than they will be in future years.
Next question, are the two math sections in the same book?
Yes.
And she is saying, yes, they are. Will there be partial credit for a math question response?
No items have partial credit, and on the multi-select items, they will need to have all of the correct ones marked in order to get credit. And one incorrect option will also make them lose credit.
So all right, or all wrong. Is there a reason dictionaries are not allowed on the writing portion of the test as we had in PASS?
Well, I think if you think about what this particular writing task is asking students to do, it's really about analyzing text. And of course, how they respond to that analysis is important, but there is no reason for them to need a dictionary for this. If you look at that rubric very closely, look at that very last bullet, and you'll see that is the only one that addresses conventions. And actually, it covers some heavier parts of conventions than just the spelling, which is the only reason that you would need a dictionary. So I think it's very important to encourage our students to analyze the text and be able to make sure those responses are getting right at that analysis. And certainly spelling would count some, but probably not nearly as much as it used to on our domain-specific rubric.
The next question is about math. Will students be given a formula sheet for pencil paper test takers?
There will be no formula sheets as such, nor rulers or protractors, unless the specific item requires that. Generally speaking, the formulas will be given within any item that needs a formula.
Stay close. Will students have one answer document or a separate answer document for each test? One for all is the answer to that one. And then I have a general question here. Is there any reason why these testing decisions have been made this late in the school year? I'm going to let Ms. Jones answer that, because that has to do with our procurement and having to procure, as the state law required, an off-the-shelf test, but I'll let her talk that through.
So the reason that it was awarded so late this year is that there is a very extensive procurement procedure in this state. You'll know that last year we administered the ACT and the Aspire test, and that was a one-year contract, so that ended in after testing last spring. Once we found out that was only going to be a one-year contract, we began writing what's called a request for proposals, an RFP. And those are about 60 or 80 page documents, and they describe exactly what we need in a testing or in a contract. We send those over to another state agency that actually does the procurement. So they send the RFP out, and companies actually spend about 3 months writing their proposals where they describe what they'll do for the state. And then we have to bring committees in to evaluate those proposals. So it just takes about 6 months to actually go from the time when you know you're going to have to award a contract until you can award a contract. And so December 1st, even though it seems like it was very late, we moved very quickly in order to award a contract that soon.
This is another special education question. What will oral administration policy be for IEP students on SC Ready and SC Pass?
So the only subject that oral administration will be allowed for on SC Ready is the mathematics. That will be available for students at all grade levels in mathematics. For SC Pass, oral administration will be available at all grade levels in both science and social studies.
I think we've answered this, but we get a lot of questions about the number of booklets in math as they relate to calculator sections and non-calculator sections. You might want to repeat that one last time.
There will be one mathematics test booklet. It will be divided into two sections. There will be visual cues on the pages to let the teachers know which section the student is working on at any given time.
There's a question about sending this PowerPoint, and as I said at the beginning of the webinar, we will post this on the department's webpage, and SCASA will also send this link out to all its members, so this PowerPoint will be available there, as well as the recording, the voice recording. The next question is, will all the multi-select items have five choices, and will questions be worded to identify they are multi-select?
In mathematics, the cue will be mark all that are correct or mark all that are true or whatever. All of the items that I have seen have five options in the multi-select. I don't know whether that will be true in the end or not.
Next question, will students that have an IEP with a calculator in the accommodations be allowed to use a calculator for the entire test?
No. This is another area where we will be conducting a validity study to determine if that can be allowed as an accommodation on future assessments. But for the time being, calculators will not be allowed for any students unless they're in grades 6 through 8 on that calculator section. So even if a student has it in the IEP, that IEP will need to be updated. We have regulations, federal regulations from 2007, which require the state and LEA to instruct IEP teams to only select accommodations which don't invalidate the score. So in some cases, it may be necessary for IEP teams to review the accommodations listed in the student's IEP and, select only those ones which provide the student are allowable that provide the student access to the assessment. I believe that in Peter's webinar that he will be doing, Peter Coit from the Office of Special Education Services, that he'll cover what to do in that instance. And if you need more information, their website will have information on that webinar.
The next question is, do we have access to DRC online resources for South Carolina? We being district schools, what access do we have? Do the districts have?
Can we swing back around to that one?
Okay.
Can we go to the next and come back?
Okay, we've got to make some movement of people here, so we'll go to the next question. When will we get more information on the gridded response?
Instructions on that the students will have for that are posted currently, have just been recently posted to the State Department website.
So we'll go back to the previous question. Do we have access to DRC online resources for South Carolina? I believe that district test coordinators have access to the DRC website, and they can access additional information from there.
Okay, we're down to the last 5 minutes, and you can imagine there are lots of questions here. We're going to try to hit some of the big topics. Are there particular changes in the SC social studies and science test, or are they pretty much the same as in the past?
For this year, science and social studies will be the same as in the past. We could be looking at changes in the future, but decisions are still being made about the future.
Is there a practice test or practice items that the teachers can access at this point?
The only practice items are the few that we've mentioned, and those are posted on the website, but we're going to post more as we can get them.
What about math tools like protractors, rulers, online tools?
Any tools that are necessary will be item specific. They will be included in the items for the items that require them. If they do not need any rulers on one particular test, they will not get a ruler, but if there is a need for a ruler, they'll get one.
The next question has to do with what you call the categories. We currently had not met, met, and exemplary. Have we named the categories yet for SC Ready?
That's still being determined. We'll know those fairly soon.
Will a reference sheet be provided for the math test for all grade levels?
Any of the formulas like we had on reference sheets will be provided within the item if they need them.
Will teachers in schools and districts be provided disaggregated data by the mathematical domain instead of and strand instead of just a single score for each student?
We are going to provide subscore information. If you look at the blueprints, that'll give you an idea of where we might be providing subscore information. And we can be more explicit about that in the next couple weeks to a month or so.
The next item says it appears that the math items are moving back more similar to what we've had with PASS. What efforts has the department taken to ensure that the items are truly aligned to the intent of the standards as they're written, and what effort to write the items to improve learning for South Carolina students?
The math items do not include any truly constructed response where they're open-ended questions. Because of the time constraints on the turnaround of the scores, we are sort of bound by the kinds of things that can be scored quickly. If we can get, in the future, maybe artificial intelligence will help us, but at this point, we don't have that available.
This question is about time, and we hear the concern that the 2.5 hours is a long time for a third grade student. I'm going to let Ms. Jones talk to you about the time when you implement a new test and what it could look like in the future.
At this point, the estimates of time, the 2.5 hours, is that it's merely an estimate. We are hoping that it really isn't going to take that long, but we wanted to estimate on the high side rather than the low side. We are attempting to make the test as short as we can, but we have to ensure that we are truly measuring the standards. We have to test the depth and the breadth of the standards. So we're going to make these tests as short as we can and still test those standards.
Okay, it's 1 minute before 5, and we want to be respectful of your time. So I'd like to tell you what we want to do with the remaining questions. We've gotten through maybe half of them, maybe a little more than half, and there are some SLO questions for Ms. Joannis as well that we have not gotten to address. We try to start with the assessment questions to kind of keep the groups moving quickly. So what we're going to do is we're going to take these questions. SCASA is going to send those to the department, and we will draft responses to those that will also be available on our website. We appreciate the thoughtful questions. We applaud you for asking them. We certainly appreciate your time late in the day today. We hope we've been able to relieve some of your concerns. I know there are always other concerns, but we truly appreciate the work you've done this year to get students ready for a test you didn't know about. And I can assure you, if you have been teaching the standards, and I know you have, then your students will be ready for what this test is going to offer. The format's different. The writing way that we're having to assess writing is definitely different than what we had in the past, but it is all still grounded in our standards. So I want you to not fret over that. And again, if we can answer any questions, and if we don't have the answers yet, we will get them to you. Please check our website, and all of the responses will be there. Thank you very much, and we hope you have a great afternoon.